Joining me now is one of the sponsors of that bill, Democratic Senator Chris Coons of Delaware, who serves on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. Senator, thanks for joining us. So, as I understand it, you don't have any Republicans on board with your legislation. Does this have any chance of becoming law?
Well, Jake, the legislation we intend to introduce in January so far has five Democratic co-sponsors. But it's our hope that there will be Republicans who will join us as well, because the core of this bill, what it does is simply make the president subject to the same conflict of interest standard as thousands of senior federal government employees. It tries to make it clear that we expect a president who is focused on doing the nation's business rather than being distracted by his own business.
Take a listen to what transition spokesman Sean Spicer said this morning about the concerns about potential conflicts of interest.
The American people have understood exactly what they're getting, and they voted overwhelmingly for him. He has been very clear about what he owns, the role of his family, and everything else since he announced that he was running for president. And they overwhelmingly elected him with all of that on the table.
Your response, sir?
Well, first, Hillary Clinton did win the popular vote. So the idea that he was overwhelmingly elected, I think, sort of flies in the face of the recent record. But more importantly, Donald Trump alone, among modern candidates for president, steadfastly refused to release his taxes. So we have no idea what the scope of his conflicts of interest might be, whether some of his major development projects were financed by Russian oligarchs, or whether he owes a significant amount of money to banks in China. And in the absence of knowing that, I think it's hard for the general public to assess whether or not he's got conflicts of interest that are impacting decisions he makes in foreign policy, particularly where someone like President-elect Trump takes such an unorthodox stance towards Russia, breaking with 70 years of Republican Party orthodoxy in suggesting that we should just turn a blind eye towards his invasion of Ukraine, his occupation of Crimea, his aggression in Syria, and his coddling of Iran and support for terrorism. I frankly think it's a question that most Americans would like an answer to, regardless of whether or not they voted for him in the election.
So I had a feeling you'd bring up the popular vote issue, and you know that in $7.99 will get you a latte. It doesn't really matter. We have an electoral college, and Donald Trump won 306 electoral votes, including in three very traditionally Democratic states, Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. And I guess the argument that we're hearing from Spicer is, look, he won not releasing his tax returns. He won with these global business entanglements and no promise that he would sever those relationships as president. Why would he be obligated to subject himself to laws that he's not subjected to as president?
Well, I think what we as the co-sponsors of the legislation will introduce in January are seeking to say is that there may well have been an expectation by the millions of Americans who voted for Donald Trump that he would disentangle himself from this global business. He had promised an announcement today, as you said earlier in this piece. He announced that he was going to sever ties with his business and has put that off until early next year. So going back to the very founding of this country, the reason that there's a clause in our Constitution saying that the president shall take no benefit or title from a foreign government is in order to prevent any complications in our foreign policy. And I do think this is a pressing question. Of course, I agree. He won the Electoral College. But I disagree that this is a subject that millions of Americans can look at without being genuinely concerned.
Let's turn to the Russian hack. You're a member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. I want to get your reaction to what Republican Congressman Peter King had to say about this claim that Russia was trying to swing the election for Mr. Trump, which the CIA seems to be putting out there. Take a listen.
I've been in briefing after briefing, and even in the public statements, the Director of National Intelligence, the Director of the FBI have all said that they don't know what the motive is. If there is a motive, it was just to disrupt the election, not to prefer one candidate over the other. And to suddenly have appear in the Washington Post and the New York Times, the intelligence community, the CIA, has concluded this. Who? Who in the CIA? Is it John Brennan? Is it some rogue person behind a desk somewhere? This is almost the CIA, people in the intelligence community using disinformation tactics against the president-elect of the United States. And that is just disgraceful.
Have you seen any direct evidence that the Russians were trying to tip the election to Donald Trump, or what do you think the motive was based on any briefing you've attended?
Well, one of the things I was struck by going back to August when I led a bipartisan trip to Central and Eastern Europe was just how broadly the Russians have been involved in overtly and covertly undermining democratic elections throughout Europe. I have been briefed in a classified setting on some of the elements of this Russian hacking, and I'm looking forward to a more thorough hearing in the Foreign Relations Committee, both a public hearing and a classified hearing. I am convinced that there was an intentional effort at the most senior levels of the Russian government to undermine confidence in our elections and thus to have an impact on the elections. But I do think there's more information that members of the Senate need to hear, and frankly, I wish that we would have some of this information released to the public, released before the electors meet on Monday, so that we had a sense of how big and how deep this is.
Senator, there's a big debate right now about the direction of the Democratic Party. Take a listen to another son of Delaware, Vice President Joe Biden, talking about white working class voters that he thinks clearly too many Democrats have been ignoring and insulting. Take a listen.
There's this sort of sense that's grown up in the Democratic Party that somehow these folks are these are good people, man. These aren't racist. These aren't sexist.
What's your reaction, sir?
Well, if you look back to the 1980s, the time in my life when I was first coming up, I cast my first vote in the 1984 election. Democrats lost, I think it was 4 out of 5 presidential elections in a row, or 4 out of 5 in a period there in the Reagan and Bush era. And our party had gotten pretty far off track and frankly hadn't engaged enough with the people who became the so-called Reagan Democrats. And I think Joe Biden, who understands America and understands our middle class better than anybody in national politics, has a real point here, which is that there's millions of Americans who voted for Donald Trump, not because they're racist, not because they're so-called deplorables, but because they wanted change. They're frustrated. They feel like they haven't gotten the benefit out of the significant increase in productivity and in wealth in this country in recent years. And they see the economy and they see our country moving past them. And they're wondering who's going to stand up and fight for them. I agree with Joe that Democrats are the natural allies of the working class in America, and that going back to the FDR coalition, we've had the ideas and the initiatives and the solutions that have met their real needs and their problems day in and day out. But we may have gotten away from that in recent years, and I think it's something that as Democrats look at our prospects going forward, we need to spend more time listening to folks who voted for Barack Obama in 2008, 2012, and then turned and voted for Donald Trump in 2016.
Senator Chris Coons, as always, thank you for your time, sir. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Jake.